Good morning, students. Hope you have watched the two videos which I have sent or the previous chapters for history, fourth chapter and fifth chapter. Start revising the notes which have been given to you. A part of the notes for mass media is remaining. I will be forwarding it to you today. Today we start off with the first chapter in political science. Total we have five chapters, children. And we'll be starting off with the first chapter today. The name of the first chapter is Working of the Constitution. Now let us first try and understand what is the meaning of the term Constitution. What do you mean by the term Constitution? The Constitution of India is also described as Bharatiya Samvidhan. And Bharatiya Samvidhan is a supreme law of India. It is a written document. It's a written document. Constitution is a written document. And why is it important? Because it is this document that lays down the framework demarcating, or it lays down the political code, structure, procedures, powers, duties of government institution, and sets out fundamental diets, directive principles and duties of the citizen. Everything, children, related to the functioning of the government of India. The structure of the government, the procedures, the process of making laws, the duties of the government institutions, officials, fundamental rights of the people. Everything is put down in this document, written document. That is why it is considered to be the supreme law of India. No power, no authority, no body is greater than the Constitution of India. The Constitution of India is described as the Bharatiya Samvidhan. And it's a written document. It contains information about the functioning of the various government bodies, administrative bodies, how to make laws, functions of all the government officials, every single thing, functioning of the local self-government, fundamental rights, duties of the citizen, everything is given in the Constitution of India. Even the directive principle, that is, when we make policies and programs, we are guided by certain principles like social welfare, Bahujana Hitaya, Bahujana Sukhaya. So all these are given. What are the main objectives of the various schemes and programs and plans introduced by the government from time to time? All this is mentioned in the Constitution. The Constitution of India, children, is the longest written constitution of any country on the earth. And Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, the chairman of the drafting committee, is considered to be the chief architect of the Constitution. Means the main person who designed the entire Constitution of India is Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. A constituent assembly was formed, and this constitution, as a constituent assembly, had several members. They were all elected from the different parts of India, and the people, the representatives who were there, discussed, debated upon the various points to be included, the various articles to be included in the constitution, and finally, when they debated, discussed, and finally it was accepted. But the main person who was responsible for drafting the entire constitution was Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Babasaheb Ambedkar. The constitution is considered to be supreme because even the parliament, that is the Lok Sabha, the Rajya Sabha, the two houses of the parliament, cannot override the constitution. Here you have a postal stamp of Dr. having the image of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, which was released in the year 2015, a postal stamp of India, the Parliament House, the Constitution of India that is mentioned, and you have the image of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. So his contribution to the Constitution, framing the Constitution, has been immense. The Constitution was adopted by the Constituent Assembly of India on the 26th of November 1949, and it became effective from 26th of January 1950. And where do you get these particular dates? When you recite the preamble of the Constitution in the school assembly, at that time you say, you repeat these, this particular point that our Constituent Assembly adopted the Constitution on 26th of November 1949, and it became effective from 26th of January 1950. Here you have the image of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, chairman of the drafting committee, presenting the final draft of the Indian Constitution. And you also see Rajendra Prasad, the first president of independent India. Then you have Jawaharlal Nehru, the first prime minister, signing the constitution. Okay. Now, children, as we proceed with the video, there are a few questions that I have put up as a part of the video. And these questions, you will have to write down the answer to these questions. These are all one sentence answers, or it may be in the form of the fill in the blank question. And these questions, answers to these questions, I want you to record an audio and send it to me. Send it to me on the group. You have to send this to me on the group. There will be 5 to 6 questions which will be put up during the time when we are doing the lesson, and you will make an audio after watching the video. You will make an audio. And you will give the answers to these questions. And first you speak out your name and standard and division. And then you will give the answers to these questions which are put up on the video. Audio recording must be done and it must be sent to me. And you can put it up in the group. Who was the chairman of the drafting committee of the Constitution? This is the first question. Who was the chairman of the drafting committee of the Constitution, and when was the Indian Constitution adopted? So we already finished with two questions. Who was the chairman of the drafting committee of the Constitution? When was the Indian Constitution adopted? So we know Constitution is a written document, and it gives us the information about how the government of India functions, the administrative system in India. The principles are all laid down in the Constitution, and the government of India has been working according to the principles laid down in the Constitution. Now, children, every day you repeat the preamble of the Constitution in your school assembly. What exactly do you mean by the word preamble? Preamble is an introduction to the Constitution. Just as in your particular textbook, you have an introduction, a preface is there. Similarly, the preamble is an introduction to the Constitution. Here you have an image of the preamble, which is there present in every textbook. In all your textbooks, you will have this page. Okay. And you're very familiar with these words because you have been reciting this Samvidhan. Okay. The preamble of the Constitution of India almost every day in the school assembly. Now, we the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign democratic republic and to secure to all its citizens justice, liberty, equality, fraternity. These are the four goals or objectives of all our policies. Okay. We want India to be a sovereign democratic republic, and we want to secure for all its citizens justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. And when did we adopt this constitution? On the 26th day of November 1949, we adopted this constitution, gave to ourselves this constitution. Let us go ahead, children. The design of this particular constitution, or this page, you know, all this design has been prepared by a person, an artist known as Bihor Ram Manohar Sinha. The Constitution of India declares India as a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and assures of giving its citizens justice, equality, liberty, and fraternity. Now, in order to fulfill all these objectives, the Constitution has made several important provisions so that all these objectives that it has, justice, freedom is protected, and citizens get justice. What are the provisions that are made, and why the Constitution becomes very important is that we can build up a progressive, developed society based on social justice and equality when we follow the directive principles mentioned in the Constitution. Now, we have another question here, children. The third question, which is in the form of a fill in the blank. Dash is an introduction to the Constitution. Next question. Dash is an introduction to the Constitution. Now, in this chapter, we will be focusing on three areas, namely democracy in India, its nature, changes that have taken place in Indian democracy. Our Constitution declares that in India, we have a democratic form of government. And what is its nature, the nature of democracy in India? What are the changes that have taken place in the Indian democracy in the last few years after independence? What about the social justice and the judicial system which is present in India and how it helps us, how this social justice is achieved? What are the various plans, programs, articles mentioned in the Constitution which help us to achieve social justice? And how does the judicial system operate in India that helps us to see to it that the social justice is achieved, objective of social justice is achieved? Now, you have a concept map, children, coming up here. There are some basic provisions which are included in the basic structure of the Constitution. Our Constitution has got, there are certain basic provisions which are included in the Constitution, and this can never be changed, children. It will always remain the same. There can be certain things that can be added to the Constitution as time passes, but the basic structure of the Constitution can never be changed. Now, what are the provisions included? Republican and democratic form of government is the first one. Federal structure of the Constitution, promoting the unity and integrity of the nation. Integrity, to see to it that the country remains united, and promotion of unity and integrity of the nation, sovereignty of the nation, secularism and supremacy of the Constitution. Now let us take up each of these points one by one, children. What do you understand by the word republic? Okay, republican and democratic form of government is the first basic provision. Republic means a state. Here the word state in political science represents a country. A state in which the supreme power is held by the people and the elected representatives. Another one addition to this word republic is the supreme power rests with the people and elected representatives. So there is no monarchy or there is no kingship. You do not have a king as the main authority here. The supreme power rests with the people and the elected representatives of the people. We do, and there is a rule of law. Everyone is considered to be equal before law, irrespective of whether he is rich, poor. There is no discrimination on any grounds. So republic means a state in which the supreme power is held by the people and the elected representatives. Again, there is a different, the two words are different. Republic, second word is democracy. You all are familiar with what is a democratic system, right? From the fifth standard you have learned what's a democratic form of government. A system of government by the whole population or eligible members of the state, typically through elected representatives. Nowadays we have the indirect form of democracy. In Greek system, Greek city-state, you had direct democracy. Here you have indirect system of democracy where we elect representatives, candidates who stand for elections, and once they are elected by a majority of people, they become our representatives. So first important basic provision provided in the Constitution is republican and a democratic form of government. Second one is federal structure of the Constitution. What do you mean by federal? Federal means dual. Federal means dual. Now, you have a federal structure in India means there are separate governments of the at the union level, that is at the central level and at the state level. And there is a division of powers between the two. The central government is at Delhi, and the state governments, the various states of India, like Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, they have their own state governments. And there is a division of powers between the center and the state. So first point, republican and democratic form of government. Second one, you have a federal structure of the federal structure in India. And that means that there are two separate governments, government at the state level and government at the central level. The powers of the central government are much more than the state government. But however, the center state government has been given certain portfolios and certain departments in which it enjoys independence. It can take its own decisions. For example, portfolios or departments like agriculture, or it can be related to education. Basic framework is given and the state can work. They have the freedom to work or have their own policies and programs. Okay. The next one is sovereignty of the nation. What do you understand by the word sovereignty? Sovereignty is full right and power of the governing body over itself without interference from any outside sources or body. That means we are free. We are not under any foreign control. Before 15th of August 1947, we were not sovereign. We were just a colony. We were a British colony. But we became sovereign only when we achieved our independence. So sovereignty is the next point. Secularism. What do you understand by the word secularism? When we talk about secularism, children, secularism means the state of India does not, the government of India does not give any special importance to any religion. We do not have an official state religion. There are many countries in the world which have Islam as a state religion. There are some other countries like UK, for example, has got Protestant type of Christianity. So many European countries have Christianity as a state religion, but in India, India is a state that supports or participates in a neutral manner when it comes to the affairs of all religious groups. No religion is given special importance. That means that all religions, people belonging to all religions can propagate their religion. They can perform worships or they can perform their rituals. They all have the freedom to do so. Okay, there is no kind of any rules and regulations which have been passed by the government in matters of religion. Only thing, when it comes to equal rights, there are certain restrictions imposed time and again so that state of equality is maintained. So in the basic framework of the constitution, we have a concept map and what are the points? 5 points are there. Republican and democratic form of government, federal structure of the constitution. And the third one is sovereignty, secularism, promoting the unity and the integrity of the nation is one of the main objectives. Now, how is the constitution supreme, children? How is the constitution supreme? Because although we have in the parliament the representatives who have been directly or indirectly elected by the people, still they cannot try to change the basic structure of the constitution. That's why constitution is considered to be supreme. Now, one more question which you have here. Name any two provisions mentioned in the basic structure of the constitution of India. Or how is the constitution supreme? Next question, how is the constitution supreme in India? So we've already covered 5 questions. Name any two, I'm repeating the question, name any two provisions mentioned in the basic structure of the constitution. 5 points are there, you have to mention any two. How is the constitution supreme in India? How is the constitution supreme in India? Let us now move to the next point, that is let us try and understand how the constitution has strengthened democracy in India. When we talk of democracy, democracy is not just a political form of government, children. It is a way of life. Democracy is a way of life. Democracy is a way of life. And democracy, when we adopt democracy over a period of time, we become expert in it and we have a representative structure. Democracy does not merely simply imply a representative structure. The essence of representative system is to integrate the principles of democracy in actual practice. That means over a period of time, we learn how to accept the opposition, how opposition party should try to be more constructive in their opposition, in opposing the principles and programs of the government, not just oppose for the sake of it. Similarly, when the representatives work, the right kind of representatives should get elected. And all this will happen over only a period of time. Democracy matures, children, over a period of time. Democracy does not imply just a representative structure. We are electing, we conduct elections and representatives are elected. But then democracy is not just a form of government, it's a way of life. Okay, and once we accept it as a way of life, we accept the principles of equality, fraternity, brotherhood, secularism, and when there is more amount of equality and everyone feels that they are contributing to democracy, only then we can say that there is political maturity and democracy is successful in the real terms. Democracy becomes an integral part and parcel of the political life of the society. Now, how do you know? We have adopted a democratic system right from the time of independence. But how do you know that democracy in India has been successful? Many a times, countries which become independent, they adopt democracy, but they, later they find that democracy is not a suitable government for them. But in India, we know that democracy has been successful. And what are the important indicators? How do you know that? Important indicators of India's successful democracy. First one is Indian people have direct representation in the parliament, state legislature, and local governments. We have government at three levels, central level, state level, and even the governments, the local self-governments, which are there. For example, you have the municipal corporation, municipal council, then you have the three-tier system at Zilla Parishad, Panchayat Samiti, Gram Panchayat at the basic grassroots level. So all this comes under local self-government, local governments, okay? So right from the lowest level, that is the local self-government, then we have at the state level, we have the state legislature having the two houses, and then you have at the central level, you have parliament, okay? So Indian people find that they can send their representative, they can elect their representatives to at all these three levels, okay? Free and fair elections are held in India at regular intervals, and the participation of the people in the democratic process or in the election process has increased over a period of time. So we know that democracy in India has been successful. This shows that democracy in India has been successful to a great extent. Now let us, shall I show you how we have one graph given here. Electors over the years. Now we have on the y-axis the number of voters in millions. And you have on the x-axis the years where the elections were conducted. And slowly we find that there has been a steady increase in the number of voters' children. This shows that number of people who are becoming aware of whom to elect, they cast their votes. And we have been successful in actually electing the right representative so that they can solve our problems. So democracy is definitely successful in India. From 17.3, okay, in 1951, when the first elections were held, today, that is in 2019, there were about, there have been about more than, okay, 910, okay, million voters, 91 crores rather, making Indian democracy the biggest democracy in the world. Democracy in India, therefore, you can say, children, is becoming bigger and better day by day. Okay. Universal adult franchise. To make democracy in India better, Article 325, 26 of the Constitution of India provides universal adult suffrage. That means, it means that all adults who are the, above the age of 21, once upon a time, when we became independent, they were all given the right to vote. But now, the voting age has come down from 21 to 18. So anybody who has completed 18 years of age, irrespective of caste, creed, sex or religion, is eligible to vote in the general elections in India. This has been one of the most revolutionary aspects of Indian democracy. So universal adult franchise, anyone above the age of 18 who has completed 18 years of age, once you complete 18 years of age, you also become eligible to vote. Only thing, you have to register yourself as a voter before the elections. India is the world's largest democracy with 1.2 billion people. So after China, when it comes to population, India has got largest population, and the number of people above the age of 18 is also very quite high. And therefore, number of voters have increased to a great extent. That is why we say that Indian democracy is considered to be the largest democracy in the world. And what are the effects of reducing? There are two textbook questions, children. Indian democracy is considered as the largest democracy in the world. Give reason. And what are the effects of reducing the voting age from 21 years to 18 years? What we are discussing here is how has the constitution helped in promoting democracy in India? What are the various provisions made in the constitution which are helping us to have a better, bigger and a better democratic government? what points will you take up here? In the pre-independence period, there were several provisions which restricted the right to vote. Right to vote was not given to everybody. But many such provisions were, many such rules, regulations were cancelled after independence. And adult suffrage was given to give the right of vote equally to both men and women who were above the age of 21. But later, this voting age was reduced from 21 to 18. And that is why what has happened is 18 years means they are youth. And they're the younger generation in India, and therefore many of them very enthusiastically cast their vote, and the number of voters in India are therefore more compared to any other democratic nation. And we are also are second largest in the population in the world, and therefore that makes India have the largest number of voters compared to any other democratic nation. Now, when you talk about this largest number of voters, it is not this change which is there is not only quantitative, but also qualitative, because we have a lot of new political parties which have been set up, and youngsters who are contributing and actively they support the various programs and policies, and therefore the younger generation is coming forward to handle the, to take up the shoulder the responsibility of running the democratic government in India. So first one is how democracy successful in India and what provisions have been provided. The second one point which we discuss here will be related to decentralization of democracy. What is the meaning of decentralization? What do you mean by decentralization? Decentralization means powers are distributed or delegated away from a central and authoritative location or a group. When you distribute the powers, when you delegate the powers from a main authority to a smaller group or a localized group, then you call it as decentralization. Decentralization, children, is very important, especially in a democratic country like India, because it's a large country with a very large area and with lots of diversity and a very huge population. Therefore, decentralization becomes very, very important. If democracy has to be successful in the real sense of the word, then decentralization is a must. Decentralization helps us to control the misuse of power, and also creates opportunities for political participation of the common people. The common people first participate in the local government, like local self government. And once they vote for their councillors, the corporators, then they start working at the lower level. They understand the problems of the locality. And then afterwards, they move ahead to the state level, then afterwards to the national level. So decentralization helps the people, to common man, to understand the real process of democratic working. Directive principles of state policy include provisions for democratic decentralization. Now, what are these policies? We have a lot of rules and regulations related to the local self-government, and that all that helps us in democratic decentralization. Okay. Now, we have made one attempt. There is a very important provision as to how to make or how to empower, make the local self-governments more powerful so that the problems of the people can be really attended to and it can be solved at the earliest by the government. So you have local self-governments and many provisions are made. One such attempt is 73rd and 74th Amendment of the Constitution. What do you mean by the word amendment? Amendment here is any kind of change which is to be brought in the Indian Constitution that can be done only when it is approved by the state legislatures and by the parliament. And such changes are brought about to suit the changing needs of the changing society. And the 73rd and 74th Amendment gave a lot of power to the local self-governing institution. It increased their powers and it made them more, to make them more efficient, their powers were increased so that democracy can function in the real sense of the term. Now, another one important provision that has been made is the right to information, which was passed in 2005. The RTI right, which was passed in 2005. Why is the RTI very, very important? Right to information is very important because it is one provision in the Constitution of India, one provision which has been made by the government of India, rather, to make the citizen more powerful. So this has been passed in 2005. So even if the Constitution was accepted in 1950, several changes or several amendments, several articles, new articles have been added. Some of them have been amended or changes have been made. Some new points have been added in order to make democracy more powerful. Citizens have been empowered by with the introduction of RTI, and RTI is necessary to create opportunities for citizens' participation and interaction with the government. We elect the representatives' children, but we don't know what they are doing, whether the policies and programs which have been put up by the government at the central level, whether they've been really implemented by the state level, by the local self-government. And many times we find that there are, our rights are taken away, and there is like there are a lot of grievances that individuals have, because many a times they find that their problems are not addressed by the government and they find difficulties. And this RTI, which is there, really helps them to solve this problem. What has the RTI done, children? This right to information is an act which has been passed in 2005, and it has increased communication. It has increased communication between the government and the citizens. We actually can make the government, every citizen has a right to know about the functioning of the government, and we can strengthen democracy and build up a relationship of trust between the citizens and the government through this RTI. And citizens have the right to know about the functioning of the government. What actually has happened because of the RTI, how it functions, we'll come to know about that also. Information to the citizens of India, information is provided to the citizen of India, and that ensures transparency. Transparency means the being open with having nothing to hide. That's called transparent. So the government's functioning is very open and they don't have anything to hide. For example, if a certain amount of funds or money has been allocated by the government for a particular program, and if the citizen feels that this money has not been utilized well or wants to know how this money has been utilized, okay, in this particular to implement this particular program, he can ask for that information, and the government is supposed to provide that information to him. It doesn't have to hide anything from the particular citizen. Accountability. Second one, transparency is first one. Second one is accountability. Willingness to accept the responsibility for one's action. In a democracy, you can't put the blame on somebody else. One minister blames another minister, state government blames the central government in turn blames the state government. And who is the ultimate sufferer? The citizen. So that should not happen. So to make the government to make the people's representatives more accountable, once we elect you, what are you doing for us? How do you take responsibility for your, do you take responsibility for your actions? Okay. So transparency, there is nothing to hide. The government cannot hide anything. Government has to give us the information about what we ask as citizens of India. The representatives must be made more accountable. Okay. The officers who are in charge should be made accountable. They must accept responsibility for the actions that they have been doing or not been doing. So transparency and accountability are the hallmarks of good governance. The right to information, children, has reduced the element of secrecy. The government functioning has become more transparent. We know what's happening on a day-to-day basis, what policies are chalked out, what programs have been made, how the funds are allocated, every single detail, how far the particular scheme has progressed. Every single thing, why it is not being completed on time, what are the reasons for that? Every single information can be obtained by the citizen of India using the RTI Act. It has reduced the element of secrecy in the working of the government. Therefore, citizens of India have got right to information, education, and food security, and all these rights have strengthened democracy in India. There are two YouTube links, children, related to the RTI. I will be forwarding that to you, and we can have one more video in which these two links are played, and I'll ask you a few questions also related to this particular two YouTube videos. You can watch them and you can answer the questions. Okay. One more last aspect is right-based approach. After independence, a lot of progress has been made towards making democracy in India more and more successful. Okay, and so we claim that India is the largest democracy, the biggest democracy, the largest democracy. Quantitatively and qualitatively, there has been a lot of improvement in democratic functioning in India. And in this whole process, who has been benefited? When democracy functions properly, its ultimate beneficiaries, who are benefited? The citizens of the country are benefited due to proper functioning of democracy, because democracy is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And in the last few decades, development is considered as the right of the citizen. The last question here, right to information has made the government more dash and has reduced the element of dash in the working of the government. I hope you have understood this particular part. And we come to the end of this session. We have discussed some points here. We have discussed about political maturity of democracy in India. Provisions made in the Constitution of India to make democracy more effective in India. And in that, we have discussed about the universal adult suffrage, where voting rights have been reduced from 21 to 18 in India. And also we have discussed about how powers have been distributed, or decentralization of powers, that has helped us in order to make the democratic functioning better. The third point we have discussed here is the right to information, which has again made the government functioning more accountable and more transparent. Government has nothing to hide. It is answerable to the people, because it is made of the people, for the people, and by the people. And so how this right to information has helped us in making democracy more effective in India. Okay, so right-based, the concept of right to information, this is a short note for that. And questions or notes related to this particular point which have been covered will be sent to you today. And you can start writing the same in your workbook, where the space is provided for the answers. And some of the questions you can even write in your notebooks. Okay, there are some questions which I have asked while we proceeded with the video, while I was explaining the chapter to you. I want you to record an audio of the answers. First, you tell your name and your standard and division, and then you will give the answers to these questions. There are about 5 or 6 questions. They are all objective type questions, and you will send this audio on the group. Do not share the answers with anybody. Do not copy from anyone. Do not share the answers with anyone. This will be treated more like an oral test, where I will understand how much you have got the chapter. And if you have any doubts, you can put it up in the group, WhatsApp group, that will be clarified. Thank you, children. Have a nice day.